Hey guys, I wanted to clarify a few things on the homework worksheet. Now that we've covered our notes on osmosis and diffusion, passive and active transport, etc. So this is the homework worksheet that you have from me. And so the first thing I want to go over very quickly is how to use a diagram like this. So if you are asked to determine if something is active or passive transport, so diffusion, simple diffusion, is just the movement of substances from high to low concentration. And in the case of a cell membrane, that would mean that it's going directly through the cell membrane. Remember, I mentioned to you that things that can diffuse easily would be hydrophobic things or lipid-soluble things because of this lipid portion of the bilayer. So, and I also mentioned nonpolar things. So oxygen and carbon dioxide are two very common things that can easily go directly through that cell membrane without requiring any kind of a protein. Now, notice our other two scenarios have a protein. I wanted to point this out because one difference between B and C is that the substances are going in B. Notice they're going from high to low concentrations. Now, in C, they are going the other way. They are going from low to high concentrations. And that does make a difference when you're determining whether something is facilitated diffusion or active transport. So B, if it's going from high to low, that means that no energy would be required, but it is requiring a protein, a helper. That's facilitated diffusion. So that's what's happening here in letter B. This is facilitated diffusion. I can identify it because it's using the help, the facilitation of a protein, but it's going from high to low concentrations, and that makes it passive transport. It's not requiring energy. Now that we look at C, C is taking something from low to high. Now, they helped you out here by including that ATP was involved. Great, that's a big clue. That tells me this has to be active transport. However, they don't have to draw ATP here. If they have low to high, you're supposed to know that that is active transport. So make sure for test purposes and AP exam purposes that you know that you don't have to see ATP. That's a very nice clue that they could include, but that's not necessary. They don't have to show ATP. If it's low to high, you're supposed to know this must be an active transport protein and energy would be required because things don't normally go on their own from where there's less of them to where there's more. Okay, moving on, I'm not gonna go over every single thing on this sheet, but this little section here is just looking at the diffusion of solutes. So they tried to show like more concentrated versus less concentrated, and then you were supposed to determine which direction the solute would go. Again, they're explaining that they want you to pretend like whatever this solute is, it is something that is, the membrane is permeable to it, so it can pass. So is there a gradient, yes or no? If it's more concentrated on one side than the other, then your answer is going to be yes. And then which direction will it go? Now theoretically, if this can pass through the membrane, it does have the ability to go both directions. But they're asking, what they mean is, would the movement, the net concentration change? Would you have more going left or right? And in this case, the net movement would be to the right. Why? Because since the chances of a molecule hitting from the left are higher than the chances of a molecule hitting from the right, there's more of a chance of a molecule going towards the right side. Eventually, once the two sides are even, this would be equilibrium, and they would be going in both directions in equal amounts, and so you would not see a concentration change anymore. In fact, there would no longer be a gradient. I'm not going to solve the other two. I want to move down and show you these. Now, in this scenario, it looks kind of the same, but in this case, they said this is a solute that cannot move across the membrane. Another way they might say this, they might say that the membrane is impermeable to that solute. So hopefully nobody asks me what impermeable means on the test because I'm not going to tell you. You need to know what that means. Permeable means it can permeate or go through. Impermeable means it cannot. So They're saying these solutes are stuck where they are, but assuming that these are dissolved in water, they want to know which way the water would go. So A, our first here, we would see that yes, there is a gradient in number one, right? The question is, which way will the water go, left or right? So remember, in the case of water, the easiest thing to do is figure out which side has more solute. That's the side that is hypertonic, and the other side is hypotonic, and water will always go towards the side that is hypertonic. Why? Because that's the side that has less water. If there's a higher concentration of solutes, that means that there's not as much space between those solutes for water. So water is technically going from where there's more water to where there's less water. Okay, so it's going to go towards the side with a higher amount of solutes, and so towards hypertonic. So the answer here would be that the water would go towards the left. Now again, water, if water can freely pass, it's technically going to go both ways. But more of it would be going to the left until the concentrations on the two sides were equal. In other words, these dots would become more spread out so that they matched how spread out the dots on the other side were. So the concentrations would become the same, not necessarily the number of dots. All right, this one is done with percents. I'll just do the first one again. So we have a 1% sugar solution, we have a 5% sugar solution. We always want to read what it says. Sugar cannot pass. So we're assuming that water can pass, but sugar cannot. So if we look at scenario number one, we see that the inside has less sugar. So this would be our hypotonic side. That would make this our hypertonic side. And our rule is that water will always go towards the hypertonic side. So the water would exit to the external solution in this scenario. Could water go the other way too? Yes, but the net change is that this cell or bag or whatever this is, this should shrink or lose weight. So that's how you do these. All right, moving on to the YouTube. So this is this one is really important. I want to go over this because I would say these are the hardest problems. People struggle the most with these problems. So first thing we want to do, so side A is hypo-hypo-isotonic to side B at the beginning of this experiment. So to figure that out, we're going to add these together. So this is 3 molar, and this is 3 molar. So that would mean at the beginning of this experiment, A and B are isotonic. However, because there is a difference in permeability, if something can pass and something else cannot pass, it's not going to stay this way. Because in this scenario, they're saying, what if glucose could pass? Which way will it go? So that means that the sucrose, every time it hits the membrane, it's bouncing off. But if a glucose hits the membrane, it's going across. Well, the chances of a glucose hitting from the right side are going to be higher than left side. In other words, glucose is going to go from where there is more of it to where there is less of it. And so the glucose would go towards side A, the side that has less, until eventually the amount of glucose was evened out on both sides. So that's how that would go. All right, now let's look at C. This is the hardest question, and you will for sure see one like this on the test. So what if glucose can pass but not sucrose? Which side would have a higher water level at the end? Again, we're assuming that water can always pass through these semi-permeable membranes. Usually it's something like dialysis tubing. All right, so here's how you solve this. Now we know that sucrose, if it could pass through this membrane, would go from high to low, and glucose will also go from high to low. In some cases, you might have glucose that would go one way, but sucrose would go the opposite way, and then you're like, well, I don't know which way the water would go. Here's how you solve these. It's very, very simple if you follow this very simple instruction. So if glucose can pass, we know glucose would technically go towards the left, right? Until it was evened out. It doesn't matter. They didn't ask us about glucose in this question. What they asked us is which way the water is going to go. Now, since the glucose can pass and it's going to even itself out, we're going to cross it out. Why? Because the glucose is not going to affect which way the water goes. Since it can freely pass through the membrane, it's going to go to the left until both sides are equal and the glucose will even itself out. So there's not going to be an imbalance for glucose. Now we are looking at our only solute here, sucrose, that cannot pass through the membrane. So once the glucose has evened itself out, we're going to be left with a hypertonic solution on the left. The left side is going to be hypertonic, and the right side would be hypotonic. Why? Again, because the glucose is going to even itself out. So the water's, it's not going to affect which way water goes. But since the sucrose cannot pass through the membrane, there's no way to even out that concentration. So the only thing that could do that would be the water. So the answer here, since now we've determined that the sucrose will be in higher concentration on side A will be hypertonic, and therefore water will go towards side A, and side A will have a higher water level at the end of this experiment. So repeating those instructions one more time, what's going to happen in an experiment like this, do all your solutes first. So any solute that can pass, it's going to go from higher to lower concentration until it basically evens itself out. So then you're just going to cross it out because that's not going to affect which way the water goes. I mean, technically halfway would mean that the glucose is now 1.5 and 1.5. So isn't it true? It's not going to change which side's hypertonic because the glucose, you're adding the same number to both sides, right? So you just cross it out. So now the water would go to A and the water level will go up on A. All right, so that's how you solve those. The last thing here, they're talking about the extracellular solution. Again, that means outside of the cell. And they want to know, let's see, they check this, so they want to know about the solution outside the cell, whether it must be hyper, hypo, or iso. So we're kind of going backwards in some of these. We're saying what happens, and then you have to figure out what the solution was. So if there's a higher concentration outside the cell, that would be hypertonic. If it's equal, that would be isotonic. An animal cell bursts, huh? Well, think about it. If water goes into the cell, then the cell must have been hyper. So the solution would have to have been hypo. Blood cell stays the same. That's got to be iso. Blood cell shrivels up. Well, if the water left, that would mean the outside must have been hyper. And again, we're talking about extracellular or outside. And then a plant will be wilted. So technically, this is actually two answers. This would be a solution that's iso, which you wouldn't think. But remember, plants rely on being hypertonic inside the plant so that water keeps going in until it creates a bunch of pressure. So we really want it to be hypo outside. If it's not hypotonic outside the plant cell is going to be kind of shriveled up. And so therefore, it would have to be, if the outside of the plant was hyper, for sure the plant would get wilted because the water would leave. But even in iso, it'll probably look a little bit wilted as well. All right, so I hope that that's helpful if you were struggling a little bit on the homework worksheet. If you still have questions, obviously come and see me and I will be glad to help you.